Good morning, children. In today's class of biology, I'm going to deal you with the question answers of the lesson, The Story of Microorganisms, Part 1. The Story of Microorganisms, Part 1. Okay, in this lesson, the questions that repeatedly asked and that are very important are being dealt with now. Okay, so the first very question of your textbook page number 35, you can open and read out the first question, that is, which organisms are interlinked between living and non-living organisms? Why do you think so? So the organisms which are interlinked between the living and non-living things are viruses. What are the organisms that are interlinked between living and non-living things? They are viruses. These are alive when they are in the body of host, but they are not living when they are outside the body of the living organisms. So, viruses are the living organisms only when they are in the body, inside the body of the living organism. But they behave as non-living when they are outside the body of the living organisms. So they can be seen only through the electron microscope. We cannot see these viruses directly. We can see them only with the help of electron microscope. So the common diseases that are attacked us due to virus are polio virus, AIDS, and for the plants that attack, they are tobacco mosaic virus. Okay, so AIDS is occurred due to the human immunodeficiency syndrome, that is a human immunovirus. Okay, so HIV, it is caused, is the virus that produces the AIDS in human beings. Okay, human immunovirus, and these viruses cause the diseases like polio, conjunctivitis, smallpox, chickenpox also. Once again I repeat, what are the viruses? Viruses are the minute microscopic organisms. They are microorganisms which we cannot see with the naked eye. They can be seen only with the help of electron microscope. They can be seen only with electron microscope. And what about them? How are they? They are non-living outside the body of the living organisms. They are non-living outside the body of living organism. Outside the living organisms. And they are living inside the body of living organisms. They act as living organisms inside the body of living organism. So when they enter the body of the living organism only, their life processes starts. Okay, so we can say that they are interlinked between living and non-living organisms. So we say they are interlinked between living and non-living organisms. Living and non-living organisms. Hope you have understood now about these microorganisms, about virus. So now you studied, what did you study up to now? You have studied about the virus. Virus are microorganisms. They are seen only with the help of electron microscope. And they are non-living outside the body of the living organism. Living inside the body of the living organism. So they have their life processes only in the body of the living organism. So they are interlinked between the living organisms and non-living organisms. Okay, children, and now the next question in your textbook is about bacteria. So what are the different microorganisms, or what are microorganisms? How can you define, how can you find them, and what are they? So microorganisms are minute and microscopic. The minute and microscopic. Micro means very small. Organisms, they are the things or the living organisms which cannot be seen with our naked eyes, but they can be seen only with the help of microscope. Okay, so microorganisms or the living organisms which can be seen with microscope only, they cannot be seen with the naked eye. Okay, so can you find them? Where they are present? They are present everywhere. They are omnipresent. Microorganisms are omnipresent. That means they are present everywhere. They are present everywhere. When you say that they are present everywhere, can you find them? Yes, we can find them, but we cannot see them with our naked eyes directly. We cannot see them directly, but we can see them only with the help of microscope. What are the different microorganisms? Microorganisms are bacteria, fungi, microarthropods, protozoans, so and virus and so on. So these are the microorganisms that are seen only with the help of microscope. So these are present at ice cold climate to the hot desert climate also. Okay, they can survive. They can survive at very cold temperatures to very hot temperatures. That is, they are present in the marshy lands or in the snow fields or also in the desert lands also. So from this we can understand that microorganisms are present everywhere. That is, they are omnipresent. They are omnipresent. That is the answer for the second question. What are microorganisms? Microorganisms are the minute microscopic organisms which cannot be seen with our naked eye. Which cannot be seen with our naked eye. Yes. Next question here. That is, whether microorganisms are useful or harmful. Okay, so before entering into this question, first of all, we'll see that how the microorganisms will be observed in the pond water. What are the microorganisms that are observed in the pond water? We have studied that the microorganisms are, so the third question, what are the microorganisms present in pond water? Microorganisms in pond water. So, what are the different microorganisms? Bacteria, fungi, virus, protozoans, and microarthropods. First you think about them. Among these, what are present in pond water, we have to test. Bacteria, they are present everywhere. So they are also present in pond water. Fungi, they depend on dead and decayed organic matter. So we can say that they develop on the dead organisms. And the virus are also microscopic organisms which cannot be seen with our naked eye. So they can be seen only with the help of electron microscope. And the protozoans. Protozoans are the minute microscopic organisms which are found in the water. Okay. So all the microarthropods, minute insects, they belong to the jointed legged or arthropods. Okay, jointed legged organisms which are also seen with our eyes and also some are seen with the microscope only. So about this, if you think, so bacteria, you know that they are present in water. How to test the bacteria present in the water? You know, the algae or the bacteria, they are present, they are different types. I said you, they are rod shaped, spherical, spiral, isn't it? So different types of bacteria, cocci, that is a cocci bacteria, coccibacteria. They are spherical. Coxibacteria, which are spherical, and lactobacillus. Lactobacillus bacteria, which are rod-shaped, and there are also spiral bacteria and so on. Different shapes of bacteria also present. So if you see the pond water, you can find the different bacteria present in it. So algae also, fungi, algae, all the microorganisms present in the pond water. So in pond water, you can see the different varieties of algal varieties, green colored structures in the pond water. If you scrape it with the spoon or anything that in the tank or any pond, you can find green colored plant like structures. If you scrape it and observe and keep it on the slide and observe under the microscope, you can find the blue green algae found in the pond water. Okay, so these are the microorganisms found in the pond water. Next question is, are the microorganisms useful or harmful? Microorganisms are useful or harmful? You know that microorganisms are useful and also they are harmful to us, causing many diseases. Now we will see about the useful microorganisms. Fourth question. Useful microorganisms. Here, the useful microorganisms as such, we can learn them as they are used for all the plants, animals, and also human beings too. Okay, microorganisms are useful for plants, animals, and human beings too. How they are useful for them? First point, that they decompose the dead plants and animals or the organic matter and return them to the soil again as they decompose them. They act as a decomposers and recyclers and return the nutrients to the soil. Further, they are useful for the plants to grow well, which in turn produces the food for the plant, animals and human beings. Okay, so this is how the first they act as a decomposers. They act as decomposers and recyclers. Recyclers. Okay, that is the first use of the microorganism, we can say. And then secondly, we can see that microorganisms help us in digestion. The microorganisms that are present in the digestive tract help for the digestion of the food in cattle or horses, and also for the plants, they help to digest the cellulose in plants. So we can see that they also help in digestion. So both plants and animals, how they are helping, we can say in this manner. Okay, and they are helping us in the preparation of food materials such as idli, dosa, bread, these in preparation of food. That is fermentation process. You can say as fermentation. For fermentation process, for the preparation of idli, dosa, bread, cheese and all, they are used in this preparation of these food items. Okay, so these microorganisms are used for fermentation purpose also. They are used in the preparation of alcohol and they are also used in drugs, production of drugs, production of alcohol and drugs. Many medicinal values are in the industries they are used. In industries, in the bakery, in industries, industries, and they also have most of the medicinal value also. Microorganisms is of medicinal usage also. Okay, they are used in the preparation of the vaccines and so on. So we can see the use of microorganisms in different manner as they are useful for plants, animals and human beings. So they are used for the preparation of alcohol preparation in industries, and also here for the drugs, preparation of many drugs, they are being used, drugs in the sense of medicinal value. Okay, so these are the uses of microorganisms. They decompose the dead decayed organic matter and return the nutrients to the soil, in turn help for the fertility of the soil and improve the growth of the plants. And next, coming to the digestion. Digestion, that is, they help in the digestion of the food, that is in the intestine. They are in the, present in the intestines of the animals and cattle or the horses, and they help for the digestion. Okay, and they are also present to digest the cellulose that is present in the plants. And next, preparation of food, that is fermentation. Idli, dosa, cheese, big preparation of idli, dosa, cheese, and also the bakery products like bread and cakes and so on, they are being used, and they are also much of industrial purpose, use of industrial purpose in the preparation of alcohol also they are used, and in the production of drugs. Okay, so we can see the microorganisms are useful to us in many ways. And now, harmful effects of microorganisms. Now we will see about the harmful effect of microorganisms. So here, harmful microorganisms. How are microorganisms harmful to us? Microorganisms, all bacteria, fungi, viruses, they are harmful to the plants, human beings, and also animals. Plants, animals, and human beings. As we said, they are useful for plants, animals, and human beings. They are also harmful for plants, animals, and human beings. What are they? They are bacteria, fungi, virus, insects, and all. They are, these mostly, how they are, they affect the plants, animals, and human beings, we'll see. In the next part of the lesson of the story of the microorganisms, we'll be learning detailedly about the harmful microorganisms that are causal to plants, animals, and human beings. Okay, so in the bacteria, you get the diseases. Human beings suffer with the various diseases like typhoid, tuberculosis, septicemia, that is blood poisoning, typhoid, tuberculosis, septicemia, and cholera. These vomitings and motions are occurring. Okay, so these are the bacterial diseases, diseases caused by bacteria. They are called as bacterial diseases. Now I'll tell you about the viral diseases. What are viral diseases? Diseases caused by the virus. They are viral diseases that are occurred for the human beings. Mostly the viral diseases like polio, it is occurred due to the virus. Next, swine flu, cold, ill, swine flu, conjunctivitis, eyes, it affects the eyes, red eyes, conjunctivitis, and chickenpox, AIDS, it is caused by human immunovirus, that is HIV, it causes AIDS. Okay, so these are viral diseases: polio, swine flu, conjunctivitis, smallpox, chickenpox, and AIDS. Okay, so these are the viral diseases that are caused with the virus to human beings. And you know very well, the fungi diseases mostly affect the plants also. Fungus, due to the fungus, you suffer from the skin diseases. Human beings and the other like plants, they suffer from different diseases, the fungi diseases like red rot of sugar cane, smut of rice, that is paddy, smut disease of paddy. Okay, the disease occurs to paddy. my disease of panic that was due to the fungi. Okay, fungi diseases in plants. So these are in plants. Okay, so smut disease of paddy you will be seeing. This is also due to the fungi. Okay, so like this, you may find different diseases that occur with the plants and also the animals which suffer with the microorganisms. So there are harmful effects of the microorganisms also. So we have to be very careful before taking food or and keep our health in a proper condition by maintaining the proper hygienic levels, not only in the surroundings, our personal hygiene and also the surroundings should be kept clean. Okay, so this is about the microorganisms in this lesson, the question about the useful and harmful microorganisms. The next question here is with, how are the human actions causing the death of useful bacteria and fungi? So there are, you said that there are bacteria which act as symbionts. They, that is some, in some leguminous plants, there are nitrogen fixing bacteria. That is the plants lack nitrogen and they get the nitrogen from the bacteria. Okay, and as such they act as a symbiotic relationship between the plants and the bacteria. So this relationship, if it affects, so how does the human actions affect the cause of that, the death of the useful bacteria and fungi? What will happen if it is continuous? If this human action is continuous, what will happen? So first of all, we'll see what is the human action that is taking place for the death of the bacteria and fungi. Normally, it takes place in the agricultural fields. The human actions, mostly the farmers, they use the pesticides, in insecticides, and also they use the fungicides also. Insecticides, pesticides, and fungicides. Why are they used? They are used to kill the insects, pests, and the fungal infections that is caused to the crop. So, use of these insecticides, pesticides and fungicides kill the bacteria and fungi present in the crops, crop plant. Okay, so indiscriminate usage of these insecticides, pesticides and fungicides, this reduces the, causes the death of the bacteria and fungi of the crop plants. And release of the industrial waste into the water affects the growth and cause the death of the useful bacteria and fungi. So here the use of insecticides, pesticides and fungicides, they cause the death of the bacteria and fungi that are affected to the crop plants, and also the usage, that is the release of industrial waste, release of industrial waste into the water. Industrial waste into the water also kills the bacteria and the fungi which are useful. Okay, so into water, water bodies, they kill the useful bacteria and fungi. Okay, and next, thirdly, excessive usage of the fertilizers. Excessive usage of chemical fertilizers also reduces the bacteria, useful bacteria that are present in the soil. So excessive usage of chemical fertilizers also decreases the useful bacteria that are present in the soil. So these are the human actions which cause the death of bacteria and fungi. So you can write that useful bacteria and fungi. So this is the answer for that question. Next, what happens if it is continuous? If it is continuous, it leads to the imbalance in nature. Ecological, it leads to ecological imbalance, we can say. So it leads, if it is continuous, it leads to ecological imbalance. So it affects the nature, food chain and nature. Okay, so that is the case. And the next question here over is, why the cooked food spoils soon but not uncooked food? Give your reasons. The cooked food contains the enzymes and the biochemicals and other things. So what are they? We'll see now. So here, why does the cooked food spoil soon when compared to uncooked food? Cooked food and uncooked food. In cooked food, the growth of microorganisms is faster. Why is it so? Because the enzymes, the biochemical substances such as enzymes are prone to be active in the cooked food. And so the growth of microorganisms will be more at 20 to 40 degrees centigrade in the cooked food. Also, the bacteria grow rapidly in the stored food also, stored cooked food also, between 20 to 40 degrees or 30 degrees also. So we can say that cooked food, the growth of bacteria or microorganisms is more in cooked food when compared to than raw food. Okay, in raw food the growth of microorganisms is comparatively less. We cannot say that there are no microorganisms at all, but there are comparatively less than compared to the cooked food. So to give the biochemical activities, that is the growth of the enzymes, that is the enzymes are more, the activation of the enzymes are more in cooked food when compared to the raw food. So the metabolites increases and they are more inactive in the cooked food when compared to the raw food. Okay. And bacteria and fungi grow more faster in the stored cooked food also. Cooked food also, the growth of the microorganisms or the bacteria and fungi, they can survive for the longer period because it can survive between 20 to 40 degrees centigrade. Okay, so the microorganisms can survive at this temperature, and also the growth of the many various enzymes which are very active at this period. So the cooked food spoils soon when compared to the raw food. Even so, the growth of the fungi is also more. So microorganisms are less active in raw food when compared to the cooked food. Okay, so cooked food spoils sooner than the raw food. And the next question here is, what questions would you like to ask your teacher to know about different shapes of bacteria? I have already told you that there are different shapes of bacteria. So you may ask, first of all, what are the different shapes of bacteria? Where are bacteria? How can we see them? So how can we identify the bacteria, whether they are spherical or rod in rod shape? Like that, you can ask several questions related to this bacteria. Okay, so what are bacteria? Well, how can they be observed? How can you see the shapes of the bacteria? How many types of bacteria are there? So there are different forms of bacteria that you can ask. So these are the questions that you can ask as you wish. Next, that are related to the bacteria and its shapes. What will happen if you add buttermilk to chilled milk? Already in 6th standard you have understood and learned about this. 8th question mana, 8th answer. If you add buttermilk to chilled milk, that is cold milk, then will it convert to curd? It does not convert to curd. It does not convert to curd. because you know that lactic acid bacillus, that is lactobacillus, lactic acid bacteria, which is called as lactobacillus, it is the bacteria, bacillus bacteria, lactobacillus, rod shaped bacteria. This lactobacillus bacteria helps to convert milk to curd, converts milk to curd. But this lactic acid doesn't form in the chilled milk when you add buttermilk to it. So it doesn't form lactobacillus, which helps for the conversion of the milk to curd. So we can say that if you add buttermilk to curd, it doesn't convert to curd because of formation of lactobacillus bacteria. Formation of lactobacillus bacteria cannot act on it. Okay, so you cannot, the milk is not converted to curd. Okay, that is the answer for this question. So you complete the questions from 1 to 8 today in your classwork and present it in the next class. In the next class, I'll continue the remaining questions, children. So hope you have understood this question answers of today's class and be prepared to answer all the questions that I have explained you today. Okay, so the homework is complete the textual question answers. Complete the textual question answers. At least you complete today 1 to 5. Later, after one day, you can take time and complete the remaining three and proceed to the further questions when I explain to you. Thank you, children. Have a nice day. Stay safe. Okay?